Heme Review is my new podcast. I talk about the hydroxychloroquine trial in depth, link in the description below. A man mistakenly drank aquarium cleaner fish medicine. This is what happened to his heart. JD is a 60-year-old man presenting to the emergency room unconscious. Paramedics tell the admitting nurse that he's coming in with his wife, KD, because she's unconscious too. You see, JD and his wife were both watching TV one late night in March 2020. They saw on the news that aquarium cleaner had been sold out across America and Australia because there was talk on the internet about it being a cure for COVID-19 disease. They only heard the name chloroquine, connected it to a medicine for their koi fish to treat parasitic infections, and thought that it could cure them if in the case they were infected. Cure is the exact word used by the French doctor in the study that was hyped by the media. Cure is not a commonly used word by doctors. In general, raise a red flag when someone throws that word around confidently. Immediately after drinking the chloroquine aquarium cleaner dissolved in soda, JD and his wife didn't feel so good. It was just a couple of tablets and hey, this virus isn't gonna infect us this time, he thought. As the minutes passed, JD started feeling some weakness in his arms and legs. He had trouble talking and walking. He started feeling dizzy and hot as his head started pounding. He asked his wife how she was doing, but then she started vomiting. JD started breathing quicker and quicker. He wanted to hold his wife's hand before he lost consciousness. KD calls for 911 as they're brought to the emergency room where we are now. Given this history of present illness, there's a few clues as to what's happening. Most immediately, JD has hypokalemia. Hypo meaning low. Kali referring to potassium, or more formally kalium, as shown by its symbol on the periodic table of elements. And emia meaning presence in blood. Low potassium, presence in blood. JD and KD clearly took way too much chloroquine phosphate, which is the active ingredient in the aquarium cleaner fish parasite medicine. Chloroquine is a strong base, so it needs to be delivered as a solid salt. The tablet aquarium cleaner that JD dissolved in soda was chloroquine phosphate. The medicinal form of chloroquine is also chloroquine phosphate. The active ingredient here, chloroquine, is exactly the same, although the excipients, that is the extra fillers and formulation parts, are likely different. Remove the idea of aquarium cleaner from your mind now. It doesn't matter that this is an old medicine that we've had for years. It doesn't matter that it's off patent. People think it's sticking it to pharmaceutical companies in using this instead of trying other therapies, but the reality is that this is still made by pharmaceutical companies. Those are all fallacies. It could work for COVID-19 disease, but the poorly designed studies don't tell us that. If the dose is just a little bit higher than what you would take for medicine, it immediately becomes a poison. And in JD and KD, it immediately became a poison. As doctors perform their physical exam on JD, they find that his blood pressure is low. He has bradycardia. Brady meaning slow and cardia referring to heart rate. The interesting thing about chloroquine is that it's based off a natural chemical called quinine, which is found in cinchona tree bark. This is a case where someone who says, "I don't think anything that is natural can be bad for you," is wrong. Quinine is natural. It's directly from tree bark. Native Americans and European colonists grounded up the tree bark and drank it because what we now know as quinine was in that bark would treat their fevers. All of this can be really bad for you if taken in a slightly higher dose than you would take for medicine. And that's the same for chloroquine and hydroxychloroquine because that natural part of these molecules all operate the same way in the body. Chloroquine is lipophilic. Philic meaning affinity for and lipo meaning fat. So it preferentially mixes with fat tissue in the body. This means after ingesting it, it immediately distributes into the body's tissues. The brain and nervous tissue are around 60% fat, meaning that chloroquine has likely entered that space, causing JD to start seizing and lose consciousness. But it's not done here, because all cells are defined by a bilipid layer. It crosses right into the cells of other tissues too, bringing us back to hypokalemia. Potassium, like sodium above it on the periodic table, is important in signaling in the body, telling tissues and organs to do things. Potassium is mainly inside cells. Sodium is mainly outside cells. Exchanging these across the cell membrane gives us signals to do things like release hormones, conduct a nerve impulse, or to contract muscle. Potassium promotes muscle relaxation. A lot of it present outside the cell means that your muscles would relax for a long time because it can't exchange with what's inside the cell. Too little present means that your muscles won't stop contracting. We've already established that these chemicals easily enter cells. We know that potassium mainly lives inside cells. So we can say with some certainty that chloroquine does something inside the cells of the body to keep potassium in, explaining why JD has hypokalemia. This explains his weakness in his arms and legs. Those skeletal muscles would have trouble with their contractions because of low potassium. This could also explain his nausea and vomiting because the stomach is a muscle too. And the most important muscle that can immediately end JD's life, the heart, is affected too, bringing us back to bradycardia. Chloroquine slows the heart rate. The heart muscles take in sodium to initiate a contraction. Calcium goes in to commit to a contraction. Both of these are positively charged, meaning that the muscle cell wants to pump out positive ions. So it uses potassium because there's so much of it inside of the cell. But chloroquine is inside of the cell. It doesn't let the potassium out. JD's heart muscle can't reset itself to beat again. This slows his heart down for several minutes. But as the chloroquine floats around JD's blood, it keeps depositing into his heart. His heart tries again and again to reset itself for its beats, but the dysrhythmia sets in. The ventricles of his heart start to flutter. Everything is thrown off sync as ventricular premature complexes start to appear. The EKG shows JD has torsade de pointe, French for a twisting of the points, which is a heart rhythm that can cause sudden cardiac death. He enters ventricular fibrillation. JD immediately falls unconscious because his heart isn't actually contracting anymore. It's just shaking in place and blood can't get to his brain. A code is called in the hospital. Doctors rush in to try to resuscitate him. They give him chest compressions. They give medicines and defibrillation, but it's too late. The rhythm is intractable and terminal. After several minutes, the code was called. But if his wife also consumed the same chloroquine phosphate and her heart is still beating, it may not yet be too late. She may still be treated and kept alive. Doctors intubate KD. They stick a tube down her throat so that a machine can help breathe for her. This protects her airway because the chloroquine has started to change her breathing rate. If chloroquine slows the heart rate down, then she should be given a medicine that will speed it up. The medicine should have a short half-life, so its levels in the body can be easily controlled. That medicine is epinephrine, or adrenaline, as it starts to speed up her heart. But epinephrine causes a shift of potassium into the cells. If she has hypokalemia too because of chloroquine overdose, then it means this would worsen it. So she was given a potassium IV to reverse the hypokalemia. But this isn't the only treatment that she needs. If chloroquine is inside of her heart cells, then we need something that's either going to push or pull it out. Diazepam, also known as Valium, which is an anti-anxiety medicine, looks like it could bind in the heart and push chloroquine out of the heart muscle and into the blood. We only happen to know this through chance, by animal studies and human case reports, but it's also been shown to work in some larger studies of chloroquine toxicity. There's likely many other things that are going on in the heart when diazepam is given, and so these are not well understood. But what we do know is that diazepam is a respiratory depressant, so mechanical ventilation is a good choice to keep her oxygenated. The idea of aminoquinoline analogs like hydroxychloroquine and chloroquine being effective antiviral medicines has been around since at least the 1960s. The reality is, even after using the original quinine for more than 400 years, we still don't really know all the different ways this medicine works. These drugs are bases. Bases cancel out acids. Cells have something called lysosomes, which break down waste through acids. If aminoquinoline can cross into cells easily and force the lysosome to be less acidic, then cells can't dispose waste. They can't function properly. This is like if you couldn't take a dump for 60 days. Everything in your body would be broken too. In parasites, chloroquine goes to the food vacuole instead of the lysosome, raising the pH there and letting heme lyse the parasitic membrane. That's how we could treat malaria, which is caused by a parasite, but also how we could treat koi fish parasite infections too. A cell infected with virus, suddenly not functioning anymore, could be a way to contain the virus. This could also stop the immune system from acting violently in the body, which is why hydroxychloroquine could be used to treat rheumatoid arthritis and lupus. But we also know that these medicines can pop open these acidic organelles. If lysosomes were meant to break things down and they break open, then they can release enzymes that will dissolve everything inside of the cell, killing it. This could be another way how it could work in the body. Chloroquine can also shuffle zinc ions into the cell. This stops DNA and RNA replication, which is what viruses use to hijack the cells to reproduce. In lab experiments, it looks like chloroquine can add sugars onto the spikes of coronaviruses, and it can interfere with immune cell signaling. Now, some people might say hydroxychloroquine is a completely different medicine than this chloroquine that JD and Katie consumed. That's the medicine that was used in the French study that in part prompted all of this hype. It is different, but only kind of. Hydroxy refers to this group compared to chloroquine, which doesn't have it. This is one oxygen bound to one hydrogen. What's water made out of? Hydrogen and oxygen. The point of drug metabolism is usually to break down the molecule so it can be more water soluble and dissolve in the urine and be excreted from the body. From a very simple level, adding in a hydroxy group makes a compound interact with water, so the hydroxy part was used to lessen some of the side effects that could come from chloroquine. All of these are reasons why it could work for COVID-19. Keep in mind, when doctors say that it's not proven to work as of April 2nd, 2020, unproven doesn't mean that it doesn't work. It has a scientific rationale for why it could work. Unproven means that we don't know if its benefits outweigh the risks, because we don't know what the benefits are. Don't tell me that the French study published on March 20th says that it works. They looked to see if someone tested positive again at 6 days after treatment. What happens if they tested negative on day 6 but then tested positive again on day 8? You're gonna say that it works then? Why were the patients who declined therapy still included as controls? Did they consent to be in the study? That's not clear. If they didn't consent but were included, then you could make a case to say that those people were experimented on without their consent. The paper said untreated patients from another center and cases refusing the protocol were included as negative controls. What's stopping them from just picking the worst cases and finding everyone who tests positive to put back on the control arm to make it look like the medicine is really doing something when it isn't? Why were there some of the controls not tested from the start? And why is the data different from the initial posting on IPSF from the one that's on MedArchive? Again, cool that they did the study, but it doesn't tell us if it works. They did a second study with 80 patients, but it didn't have a control. But it's not like the first trial had a legitimate control arm either. Look, I don't have a stake in this, but I want this thing to work. But when someone does a trial like this, they're wasting time. Had they actually designed a randomized control trial from the start, we'd be further along now. Oh, and then they also added the antibiotic azithromycin for possible bacterial superinfection with COVID-19. Azithromycin is derived off of something called erythromycin, which was discovered from soil samples. These medicines are known to cause QT prolongation of the heart. When combined with quinine derivatives, this might not be an additive risk, but a multiplicative one, possibly through the same potassium channel blockade. The US FDA approved hydroxychloroquine only use for COVID-19 inside the hospital on March 30th, 2020, because the medical teams can monitor the heart. Outpatient, it's dangerous. If you even do as much as double up a dose one day accidentally, because it distributes widely into your body and stays in your body for several days, questionable hope isn't always good hope. There's other treatments that are being tested. This isn't the only one. The others, some of them aren't even actually medicines. They should have a readout of data by the end of April 2020. But to say that this is the only thing that we have for hope is false, because we're doing other studies as well. For KD, as the medicines and her body run the course of excess chloroquine in her body, she was able to make a recovery. Take care of yourself. Wash your hands, be alert, not anxious, and be well.